is Nidhi, who's an integrated PhD student in the Department of Mathematics. She's a student of Professor Siddharth Burman and Professor Mrunal K. Ghosh from the Maths Department. So Nidhi, will take over.
Yeah, okay. Thank you for the introduction and thank you for this invitation. As you said, I'm Nidhi Rathi and I'll be presenting my work on fair allocation of resources. That's what I research on, and this is a joint work with my advisor Siddharth and two of his interns, Ishwar and Rajitesh, which are now pursuing their PhDs. Today, as I said, I'm going to talk about fair allocation resources, and I'll mainly discuss one paper and then brush through another paper. They appeared in Wine Conference 2019 and EC 2020 this year. Okay. So the theory of fair division addresses the fundamental problem of allocating resource among agents with equal entitlements but distinct preferences. So in this work, we study the algorithmic aspects of fairly allocating a divisible and heterogeneous resource. And typically, it is known as a cake in our literature. And such resource allocation settings have been extensively studied over multiple decades in economics, mathematics, and now finally computer science have started taking an algorithmic point of view to this particular field. So what do I mean by divisibility and heterogeneity over here? The resource is divisible in the sense that you can fractionally assign it, and it is going to be heterogeneous. That is, it is not uniformly valued. Furthermore, it may differ for different participants. And typical applications include things like land division. So now note that land can be fractionally assigned and different people can value regions of land differently. The key highlight of this talk is that we establish rare and interesting algorithmic results for cake cutting by developing efficient algorithms for approximate fair cake division. I'll define every term in this particular statement, approximate and what is fairness. And also, please stop me wherever you have any doubts, because I do realize these things are new to all. So I'll try to develop the model slowly, and then we'll discuss some technical details. Okay. So now let me go on to describe what is the model mathematically. So in the classical model of cake cutting, the divisible and heterogeneous resource, that is the cake, this is modeled as a unit interval 0, 1. And we are trying to divide the cake among n agents in this fair division exercise. Also note that this is also quite useful in interval scheduling problem. The 0, 1 is an interval and you need to somehow divide it in some fair manner. Here we'll be having n agents among whom I'll divide this particular cake, and the cardinal preferences of agents over the cake are expressed in terms of numbers, and they're specified by density functions, and I'll be denoting them as VA, like a value density. So also the subscript will identify the agent, that is V sub A refers to the value density of agent A over the cake. So let's say for some agent A, his value density may look something like this over the cake, and for any interval x comma y, the under area of this curve specifies the value of the agent A for this particular interval, and we'll denote it by V A of x comma y. So that's the model. Given a cake, n agents and their value densities, what's the problem now? The problem is to divide this cake into n partitions by making exactly n minus 1 cuts in the cake. That is, every agent must get a single connected subinterval of this resource. It's not the case that we are dealing that one agent can get a piece somewhere here and somewhere there. Every agent must get a connected interval of this particular resource. Again, here piece I sub A is assigned to agent A, and I'm following the same convention. The entire exercise is to find an n partition of the cake and assign exactly one interval to each agent in some fair manner that we'll be discussing shortly. While there is extensive work on non-contiguous fair division, where an agent can receive multiple intervals, throughout we focus on a more challenging setting where each agent is assigned a single connected interval. And in many applications, contiguity is a natural requirement of the problem, such as in land division. So the fundamental notion of fairness in this line of work is that of envy fields. This notion was introduced by Foley back in 1967, and since then there has been an extensive literature of work. As the name suggests, a cake division I, which is I1, I2, I3 and till IN, this is said to be envy free if and only if each agent prefers its own interval, which is being assigned to him or her, over that of any other agent. Therefore, the notion of fairness translates to saying that, you know, look at the interval I sub A that is assigned to agent A. Look at her A value, that is VA of I sub A. This value must be at least as high as agent A's value for any other interval IB on the cake. Do note that on both sides of the inequality, I'm invoking agent A's valuation. So look at the picture. So what we want is every agent must be something like feeling something like the middle egg. They're all satisfied with what has been assigned and do not really want to swap.
Question?
Yes.
Is the family of VA arbitrary or is it something that's known only to the agents?
Oh, so that is a private information, if you may, and it is known only to the agents. And they are, they just consider them as a probability distribution over the resource.
Probability distribution.
Yeah.
No, but so, the value that an individual derives is the measure associated with the interval that he is getting.
Exactly.
So, but you're saying that when everybody is given the entire cake, their valuation is one. Is that what you're saying?
Exactly. Yes. Okay. I forgot to mention that point. Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
But yeah, for all the agents, they basically value the whole resource at one. We've normalized it.
Okay. Now, one other question. Sorry to interrupt. The agents must know the VA family, perhaps, or are you assuming that it can be any measurable function?
Any measurable function, yes.
Any measurable function. Yeah. Is it supposed to be measurable?
It is supposed to be measurable, yes. And agent A knows just his own valuation. He doesn't know any other.
No, that is correct. About the others, what is my assumption? I'm an agent. I know my VA, and you're saying it's measurable. But what do I know about the others? They come from the class
all of them are. All of them are measurable.
All of them are measurable and they integrate to one. They're positive and integrate to one. That's it.
Yes. Right. And as a probability distribution allows, if you want to know the value for two disjoint subintervals, you just add them at the respective values with the sigma integrity.
Okay, thank you.
But they're all measurable and it's a probability distribution over the resource. Okay, so I hope the notion of envy freeness is clear because that would be crucial in the coming slides. So what I'm saying is agent I looks at the interval that is being assigned to her, looks at all the other intervals made on the cake in the particular division I, and says that, you know what, I'm happy with what I've been assigned and I do not really want to swap. And we call such a division as being envy free. There is absolutely no envy in the system. Okay, so this is a very, very well studied notion of fairness and is a very strong notion of fairness as well. And so what about the existence? First of all, Stromquist in 1980, he showed that it is possible to guarantee an envy-free cake division in which every agent receives a contiguous piece of the cake. So first, so good. So we do know that such envy-free cake divisions with connected pieces, that is every agent gets a single connected piece, it is guaranteed to exist. Also, Stromquist's result together with Su's topological proof of existence, he gave another proof of existence, which was topological in nature. They are these both tools are widely regarded as the cornerstone of the cake cutting literature or fair allocation literature. Almost 30 years later, though, Stromquist himself showed that with respect to algorithms, you know what, we are out of luck. Let alone exponential time or doubly exponential time algorithm, there is not even a finite time algorithm. That is, this notion is computationally intractable. Though this result holds in the adversarial model, nonetheless, it's a very strong negative result. These algorithmic results for NV-free cake division remains elusive even if we relinquish the contiguity requirement. The best known algorithm for the setting where we do not focus on connected pieces and allow for disconnected pieces is a hyper exponential time algorithm by Aziz and McKenzie in just in 2016. And this hyper exponential is like a tower, 6 hours of n. So they showed that if you relax the requirement of contiguity, I can at least give you a finite time algorithm, which is hyper exponential in time. Okay. So even though, as you've seen, NV-free divisions are guaranteed to exist, it is computationally intractable and there are strong negative results with respect to computation. In the light of these algorithmic barriers, what we show is that there exists an efficient algorithm for finding NV-free cake division with connected pieces whose NV is multiplicatively bounded by half. What do I mean by that? I mean to say that we'll be developing an algorithm which runs in polynomial time, which will be half NV-free, and what we do is we just slap a half factor on the RHS side of the definition of NV-freeness. So VA of I sub A, it should be at least VA of I sub B to be NV-free, but what we are guaranteeing is that I will be constructing an allocation or a cake division where it is at least half of VA of all the other intervals meet on the cake. And that is what we call as half NV-free.
So I have a question. Yes. Can I ask a question?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, this is Vaibhav here. So one question I had is that are these number of divisions, are there can be multiple such divisions, right, which are NV-free?
Definitely.
So is the number finite or can there be an infinite number of solutions also? Is there any result on that as well?
I don't know. You just let me have identical agents, like having identical relations, then maybe yes, but no one. So the first thing is to even find one. We do know that there exists, but to answer your question, I think there can be multiple NV-free allocations, but I don't know of infinite such cake divisions. And no okay. one has really worked on.
Okay, yeah, because I mean, even if finding one might be difficult, but showing that there might be infinite might be possible, even though finding any might be very difficult. So that's why.
I mean, it's just my hands, but I don't think so infinite NV-free cake divisions are possible. I don't think so. Even if they're all identical agents having, which means having identical valuations, then also there exists a unique NV-free cake division, which is you give every agent one nth of the resource. So okay, I don't think so. I'll try to think more about this question, but I'll say no. But yeah, there might be multiple NV-free cake divisions for sure.
Okay. Thank you.
So what our work is doing is, in the light of all these algorithmic barriers, we are developing half NV-free cake division. We are developing an algorithm that computes half NV-free cake division, and you do understand by now that what does that mean. You just add in half multiplicative factor on the right hand side of the equation. Okay, so this is about NV-freeness. I'll now also define one more notion of fairness, which is Nash social welfare, and then quickly jump to describe the algorithm. So this notion of Nash social welfare, this creates a balance between fairness and overall economic efficiency that can be achieved. And And the relevance of mass social welfare as a measure of fairness and also of economic efficiency motivates its study in the cake-cutting literature as well. So let me now define. For a cake division, I define a mass social welfare as nothing but the geometric mean of the agents' valuations. What they are getting V of I. These are their values. I take a geometric mean of all these values, and that's what is a mass social welfare of that particular cake division. And obviously, Nash optimal allocation would be something which optimizes this geometric mean of the valuations. And as I've said earlier, this notion balances fairness and economic efficiency of a cake division. But I wouldn't go much in detail for this notion. And quickly jump back. I'll tell you some results which we developed here, but wouldn't discuss in detail. Okay. So what are our main results here? The key contribution of this work is that we are developing an efficient algorithm for computing cake divisions, that is half NVC, that is NV is multiplicatively bounded by half, which again, to reiterate, means something like this. And secondly, we also developed an efficient algorithm that develops or that constructs in a cake division whose Nash social welfare is at least one third of the optimum. So note that the problem of Nash social welfare is an optimization problem, it's a maximization problem. And what we develop is an algorithm that finds a cake division whose Nash social welfare is at least one third of the optimal which could have been achieved in the given instance. Along with these algorithmic results, we also develop hardness results and prove that for cake division instances with piecewise constant valuations. What do I mean by piecewise constant? It just means that those VAs are piecewise constant. So there are intervals where it's constant and hence piecewise constants. And for such cake division instances, we have shown that the problem of computing a Nash optimal allocation is APX hard. Again, some of you might not be familiar with this class of complexity. It is coming from the word approximation, and it says that there is some constant C beyond which you can never ever come up with an efficient algorithm for. So let's say there is some constant C greater than zero such that this problem, this optimization problem, cannot admit a 1 plus C approximation unless P equals N. So APX hardness, to show APX hardness is a way to show that, okay, you cannot have 1 plus epsilon kind of approximations. There is a barrier and that constant is given by the hardness. Okay. Now, I will move on to give an overview of our algorithm, which achieves half NV fairness. So, in this algorithm, what we're trying to do, we're trying to find an allocation where NV of every agent is multiplicatively bounded by half. So, how does our algorithm work? I start with a partial allocation and I always maintain a partial allocation. What do I mean by that? There are some pieces in the resource currently which are not allocated, and hence it's a partial allocation. And to begin with, I assign an empty interval to every agent, and then I slowly and slowly give more and more to each agent, and I'll tell you when to stop. So in the beginning, I give a plate to each agent, and there is no cake on anybody's plate, and at every point I'll make a hypothetical allocation. And I'll maintain one invariant. What is that invariant? It says that, okay, consider the figure. You have, so all the UIs mean that they are unassigned currently, and TA implies that in our hypothetical allocation, agent A is currently assigned piece PA, agent B is currently assigned piece PB, and so on. But what is the invariant I'm maintaining throughout my algorithm? I'm saying that amongst the allocated pieces, the NV is then too much additive. So by which I mean that if agent A looks at what he's hypothetically being allocated right now, which is P of A, and he looks at the value he's getting from this particular piece, which is VA of P sub A. This is not so, and then he looks at all the other allocated subintervals, VA of PBs. The NV additively isn't too much, and it is bounded by 1 by N square. So you might envy someone else, but it is additively quite small, and it's a Pauli factor of 1 by N square. So initially, everyone gets an empty set. So of course, the invariant holds true because beggars cannot envy each other. They all have empty interval at the beginning of our algorithm. But nonetheless, what do I do next is I look at an unassigned piece, which initially is the entire cage. And I find one unassigned piece that has large enough value for some interval. So do note that the invariant is saying nothing about their NV for the unassigned intervals. It can be high. And that's how I proceed in the algorithm. I find one such unassigned interval, which is of high enough value to some agent. And by high enough, I mean that he is valuing that unassigned piece much, much more than what he's been assigned currently.
Question?
Yes.
How do you pick these PAs? Is it arbitrary, or you look at region where PA is high or something like that?
No, nothing like that. I'll try to explain what I mean. So what we're doing is we're beginning with PAs are all empty at the beginning of our algorithm, and then you look while there is an unassigned piece of high enough value, I do these assignments. I'll try to explain in the next point. But these PAs are not something like where VAs are high or not. It is not necessary. But I'll explain explicitly how PAs are found or how PAs are maintained at each step of the algorithm.
Yeah, thanks.
So one quick question.
Yeah.
Can I ask?
Yeah.
So what I wanted to ask was, I'm a bit confused. So in each iteration of your algorithm, do you ensure this invariant holds, or only make sure it holds when you make this hypothetical allocation?
At every step of our algorithm, I do maintain this invariant. And anyway, each step consists of hypothetical allocation. So the two options which you gave me are the same, if I'm not missing anything.
Okay.
Or did you mean anything else?
Maybe when I look at the algorithm, it will become clear.
Yeah, because the algorithm is doing nothing but creating hypothetical allocations at each step. And at each step, I'm maintaining this invariant. There's nothing else my algorithm is doing.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So do take a good look at the invariant I'm maintaining at each step. I'm saying that, sure, it is very much possible that you are envying the unassigned pieces, but what I'm ensuring is that you are not envying the assigned pieces by too much. That envy is additively bounded by 1 by n square. Okay, I mean, just in particular, do know that at the beginning of my algorithm, everyone envies that big unassigned piece, which is the whole thing. Because at the beginning, I'm assigning empty interval to everything. Okay, so to repeat myself, what I do next is I search for some unassigned piece, that's high enough value for some, and the algorithm keeps iterating as long as there is an unassigned piece of high enough value, and some part of this piece, say U, is assigned to a judicially chosen agent. I'll again tell you how that agent is being chosen. And so some part of U is being now given to that judicially chosen agent who relinquishes the previous interval assigned to it, but now accrues a higher valuation. Okay. So to be precise, what I'm saying is there's a while loop running the algorithm. It says that while there exists an agent A and some unassigned interval U in my current partial allocation, such that VA of PA, such that his value for this unassigned interval u is at least 1 by n square more than what he's getting current. That is, VA of u is at least what he's getting currently. That is, VA of PA plus 1 by n square. So as long as I have such an agent and such an unassigned interval, such that he's valuing that unassigned interval much more, and by much more I mean at least more than 1 by n square of what he's being assigned currently, what I do is I perform a moving knife procedure, and I'll tell you what that is, but I'll perform a moving knife procedure within this interval too. So just take an example here. Okay. Is someone saying something? Because I heard.
One question here. So here you have unassigned in the figure. You have intervals U1, U2, U3, which are unassigned at this point, right?
Yes.
So is it true that U1 can only be assigned to agent 1, U2 can be assigned to agent 1 and is?
No, definitely not. I mean, any agent can go, I mean, PA, like agent A can relinquish his current piece, PA, and go and grab some part of U3. It's very much possible.
Okay. So these assignments are not nested. I mean, we can completely disregard one. Okay.
Yeah. Like the order of the agents can completely go bizarre. I mean, can completely change.
Okay. Thanks.
Just another question in this regard. Agents are not strategic during the course of these procedures. Like, for example, if you have a certain procedure here, and then agents are, let us say, doing the knife moving procedure. It looks like who's doing the knife moving procedure? Agents or some neutral individual, social planner?
Yeah. So agents are only doing it, but since I'm not assuming strategic motion anywhere here, so very well a neutral agent.
Then the kind of thing that you're trying to come up with is you want to find a solution, that's it. But through these stages, agents are just obeying whatever is the algorithm suggesting.
They are
non-strategic behavior through the process. Okay, all right, thanks.
Yeah, I'm not coming with a truthful mechanism or strategy proof mechanism. I'm coming with an algorithm currently. But as you have pointed it out, we are working towards strategy proof mechanisms in other areas of cake division.
Okay, thanks.
In particular for national social welfare, that's what we are working currently towards.
Yeah, what was the point about the NASH solution?
Yeah.
How is that connected to this?
Yeah, okay. I just wanted to tell that for NASH social welfare as well, we have developed efficient algorithms that compute 1/3 of the optimal. And also, we've also come up with one more result that says that, okay, if you have some alpha NV3 allocations, and currently I'll be developing 1/2 NV3 allocation, then you have 2 alpha, then that particular allocation itself would be 2 alpha NASH optimal, which means that so at the end of this particular algorithm, whatever allocation comes out, it would be 1/2 NV3. I know that from one of our results, it would also be achieving 1/4 of the NASH optimal, like twice, 1/2 alpha.
Okay. Thank you.
That's one of our results. Yeah. Okay. So what we're doing, what is this iterative algorithm doing? It's saying that, okay, whenever there exists some agent A and some unassigned interval U such that that agent is valuing that unassigned piece, or he's envying that unassigned piece more than an additive value of 1 by n square, I perform some moving knife procedure within this interval. So quickly, let me take an example. So let's say U2 is that unassigned intervals for which both agents A and B have high enough value, and in particular more than 1 by n square of what they're being currently assigned. So what I'll do is I'll start from the left-hand point of U2, and I'll keep on going towards the right, and as soon as some agent shouts and say that, you know what, I've now achieved more than 1 by n square, I mean plus 1 by n square of what I've been assigned right now, let's say in this particular example, agent A shouts, and what we'll do is we'll exactly do this. PA or agent A will now be assigned this part of U2, and he'll relinquish his previously assigned interval. So U1 will become the whole of U1 union PA, and PA or agent A would be assigned a piece of U2, which is exactly what you see on the screen. But again, do note that both agent A and B were competing for a piece of U2 here. Both agents wanted that piece, but agent A achieved that plus 1 by n square faster or earlier than agent B, which means that I'm still maintaining the invariant even with the new PA, because since agent B did not shout, I know that he or she cannot be valuing that piece more than 1 by n square of what he's being assigned, and which means that I'm maintaining the invariant for agent B as well, because agent A is anyway fine because he's being assigned a higher interval, but agent B also is doing fine as far as my invariant is concerned.
So Nidhi, I have a question.
Because
You mentioned to one of Vaibhav's questions that if agent A is trying to compete with agent B, let's say for the piece U3, for the unassigned piece U3, let's say it's competing for U3, and then let's say you do the moving knife procedure, and then agent A shouts that it has already got that. So all of this is still taking into account that each agent should get a contiguous piece of the interval, right?
Definitely.
You will still make sure that happens, right?
Definitely, because even in this example, do note that. So what will happen is agent A will relinquish his current piece completely and go and take up that part of U3, which is a connected interval.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So at every step or at every iteration of my algorithm, every agent, if there comes a point that his allocation is changed or his piece is changed, he relinquishes that piece, he let go of that piece and go and take up another connected interval which is of higher value as previous. Yeah, so in this case also, or in this example also, what was happening was U2 was such unassigned interval which both agent A and B wished to have or had a higher value for this particular unassigned interval as compared to what currently they've been assigned. And then you perform this moving knife procedure starting from the left. And since this is a moving knife procedure, this part of U2 will be a connected piece. And in this example, agent A shouted before than agent B. And hence, in the next iteration of my algorithm, agent A is assigned that piece of current, like that piece of previous U2, and U1 becomes the whole of previous U1 and PA. Yeah.
What if there are multiple such intervals, unassigned intervals?
Sure. Yeah, definitely. In the start of your algorithm, there will be multiple. But what you do is one by one, you keep on doing and keep on doing this moving knife procedure for each unassigned interval. Let's say at this point, both U2 and U3 both were such unassigned intervals having higher values. So either way, there's no order that needs to be followed. You could have done the moving knife procedure for U3 as well, or in this case, as I did before.
Okay.
Sorry, one question again. If you don't mind, can you explain what do you mean by the moving knife procedure? Do you move the endpoints of the intervals, or what do you do?
So what happens is how, so the algorithm, how does it have the excess of these valuation functions in VS? It has excess in terms of two, or it has oracle excess in terms of two queries. One of the queries is cut. And what do I mean by that? It says that the neutral mediator or anyone, he'll ask agent A to start from this left-hand point of U2, and he'll say that, okay, starting from this left-hand point of U2, give me that point of the piece of U2 where you'll have value equal to VAPA plus 1 minus square. So that is one of the queries, or that is the standard query model which is being employed in the cake cutting literature. And what is it? It just says that, okay, starting from this initial point and having this target value some tau, give me that particular point y or something such that, and let's say the initial point was x, such that you value the interval x comma y at tau. So here also I'll make queries for all the agents contesting. Let's say here agent A and B were contesting for U2. I'll make one query to agent A saying that, okay, give me the cut where you achieve your current value plus 1 by n square. And also I'll ask the same question to agent B and I'll say, okay, give me that particular point starting from the left end of U2 till where you'll achieve VB of PB plus 1 by n square. So in, it turns out in this particular case, the cut for PB, agent B was further and agent A was before agent B's cut, and hence agent A wins this piece.
Thank you.
Okay, I have one more question, sorry. So here, let's say agent A is searching a feasible cut in interval U2, right? So that interval in U2 can lie anywhere in U2. So how do you search, like within U2, where to make the cut for that interval?
Yeah. So that's what I was explaining. The algorithm has these two queries that it can make. One of the queries is this cut query, where it says that, okay, starting from X point of the on the cake and having some target value tau, give me that particular cut point Y such that you value the interval X comma Y, which would be a connected interval because it's an interval. You value this X comma Y at the target value tau. So here the target values would be VAPA plus 1 by n square and VBPB plus 1 by n square. So these are the so in the cake cutting literature, this query is how you access the valuations. One query is called cut query, which I've just explained, and the other is eval query, where you evaluate, where you just ask the agent, okay, given the interval x comma y, how much you value this interval, and this is called an eval query. So that's the only way you can access these valuations. You're not given the valuations explicitly, and you can just make these cut and eval queries. So here, at this particular step, if there are two agents contesting for U2, I'm making two cut queries, each one for agent A and one for agent B. And I'm just simply seeing whose cut is before whose. And whoever cuts the first is assigned that particular piece, and he relinquishes his previously owned interval. So it's not like
I'm searching. Okay, so just to add to Vaibhav's question, can it be possible that the moving knife procedure on U2 searches the middle portion of U2 and not necessarily starting from the leftmost point of U2?
I mean, in our algorithm, I'm needing it from the left-hand point. But yeah, in general, cut queries can start from any point, having any target value.
Okay,
but
okay.
Not in this algorithm. I mean, okay, why I can't do it? Simply for the reason that, let's say I'm starting from the middle point of U2 and I want every agent to start from the middle point of U2 and tell me the cut where they achieve VA of PA plus 1 by N square, it's possible that the right half of U2 is not even valued that much. It can be much, much small. It's possible that agent A is putting a lot of mass towards the left half of U2 and not towards the right half. I just know that he values the whole U2 at some value which is greater than VA of PA plus 1 minus. I don't know where, I don't even know if I start from the middle point, I'll even get a feasible reply.
One question in this regard. So when you're starting from the empty sets, so mm-hmm. that's how you have initialized it for all the agents at the start, right?
Yes.
How do you move from there in the sense that what is the next, who makes the next cut in?
Yeah. So what happens there is there is only one unassigned interval, and I know that VA of PA is zero for all agents because they have nothing on their plate currently. So
yeah.
So it's just 1 by n square. So I know that VA
of current, smallest.
Yeah. So it will be starting from zero, and I'll ask each agent to make the cut where they achieve 1 by n square value 1 by n square. And whoever achieves it first is assigned that interval. And that's the
first
I think.
But this moving knife thing for the other agents has to apply from the next step onwards, right? So they
in the first step only all N agents will participate. Because all N agents' current value is zero.
Okay, so the first guy who gets a 1 over N square is
starting
going to get the cut.
Yeah. It will be assigned. And still all the remaining agents are still at zero. So it would be something like PA and the whole of the rest cut is still unassigned.
Okay.
And then in the next iteration, again, the same thing happens. Elaborate on that. In the next iteration, it is very much possible that I'm pretty sure all the other agents other than agent A will participate because they are still at zero, but it's possible agent A will also participate because he's just got 1 by n square. The remaining value is 1 minus 1 minus square, so therefore the remaining of the unassigned interval is of value greater than 1 by 2, 2 by n square. So he will also participate. It's possible that he still wins the second round, but then he'll relinquish his previous piece and his piece will just move slightly towards the right. And
yeah, his piece moves.
And he'll get, so you'll get unassigned interval in the
2 over n square. Yeah.
Yeah. In the start, you'll get some unassigned interval, then agent A's piece, then unassigned interval. But it's possible that some other agent will need
interval. Yeah.
Any other questions? Okay. Yeah, okay. So I do these iterations and I stop this while loop, but this while loop gets halted when there is no unassigned interval such that there exists any agent who values it more than 1 plus n square of its current value, which means that this is my excitation, which means that at the termination of my while loop, I'll have now two properties. First would be within the assigned interval, which is the invariant I've been maintaining all along. And the second is, which is coming from the fact that the while loop terminated, which means that every agent values the unassigned intervals not more than 1 by n square of the current. It is VA of PA is at least the value of any unassigned interval minus 1 by n square. I've just shifted 1 by n square over there. So just take the negation of this particular condition of while loop, which is VA of PA plus 1 by n square is greater than equal to VA of U. And this happens for all unassigned intervals because your while loop has terminated, which means that now just shift 1 by n square towards the right. And you get this condition at the termination of the while loop, which says that every agent values his own piece at least at least what he values any other unassigned piece minus 1 minus 1, which means that, or which translates to saying that the envy among the assigned and unassigned pieces is not more than 1 minus square additive. So I get these two conditions at the termination of my while loop, one from because the invariant was being maintained, and the second since the while loop terminated. Okay. So also, it is very clear that at the end of, or not just at the end, at any step of the of my algorithm, there can be at most n plus one unassigned intervals. It's possible that it's like u1, p1, u2, p2, and then u3, which means that there are three unassigned intervals for two agents. But what we proved recently while having discussion with some other researcher, we showed that you can show that at the end of the, at the termination of the while loop, there are at most n unassigned intervals and not n plus one. And having these three facts, the two equations and the fact that there are at most n unassigned intervals, what do I do next? Do note that I need to come up with a complete allocation. There cannot be unassigned intervals. I cannot let go of the resource freely. So what do? I just club them. I do something stupid here. So in my final output allocation, I sub A, which is the interval now assigned to agent A, would be, I'll be just clubbing intervals. So U1 with PA, U2 with PB, U3 with EC, and so on. And I know that since there are n, at most n unassigned intervals, everyone will get at most one, everyone will be merged with at most one unassigned interval. Okay, also I make sure that the key point is that every time I make a progress, the valuation of agents do go up by a little, right? At every step, the valuations of the agents are going up by a little. In particular, whoever is winning, his value goes up by at least 1 by n square. And by that particular fact only, I can show that the while loop will terminate in polynomial time, because the whole piece is valued at 1. It cannot just go on forever. It will terminate in polynomial time, and we obtain these two properties. And along with the fact that I'm now, for the final allocation, merging one assigned interval with his neighboring unassigned interval, I first of all get a complete allocation. Secondly, I get a connected cake division as well. And how do I achieve half envy freeness? Since agent A is not envying U1, okay, look at agent A and look at his envy for agent B. So he's not envying PB by too much by the first inequality. He's not also envying U2 by too much by the second inequality. And hence, by merging and by simply adding, we get half envy freeness at this particular point. And that's all. So we achieve an allocation where the envy is multiplicatively bounded by half. So we couldn't exactly get envy freeness, because anyway we have known that it is computationally intractable notion of NS. But what we give is an efficient algorithm for approximate and in particular half envy free cake divisions. And so also very interestingly, there were no previously known approximation algorithms for this notion. There were additive approximations known, but even though it's a well-studied notion of fairness since the 80s, multiplicative approximation algorithms were not known. And even after, like recently, we improved our algorithm from 1/3 to 1/2. Having this 1/2 multiplicative guarantee also now meets the current additive guarantees. So it's the best algorithm known for envy freeness, for approximate envy freeness yet. Okay, at this point, any questions? Okay, So I'll want to talk about the of my
recent results.
Can
I ask?
Yeah.
So I just wanted to ask, how is the half and the 1 by n square related? I mean, instead of 1 by n square, can I choose something else? And definitely, do you think we can get like any epsilon between 0 and 1 instead of half?
First of all, this 1 by n square is not necessary. It can be any 1 by polynomial in n. 1 by n cube, 1 by n to the 4 will do. But I don't think so. Following the same algorithm and the same analysis, you'll get better than half. You need to do something something else, something even more clever. Yeah, but with
In short, how do you get that half? Like, is there like a quick argument why you get half then?
Oh, the argument is exactly this, because I'm merging. So look at agent A and then look at his envy towards agent B. Since he's not envying the unassigned interval by too much, and he's also not envying the assigned interval TB by too much. And I simply, since IB is now the union of these two pieces, he's not envying U2 by too much and not PB by too much. I get half simply by adding. There's nothing else going on.
Okay, thank you.
Sure. Okay, I would very, very quickly want to go over our recent results, which is which appeared in EC 2020. So do note that I know that there are a lot of computational barriers in this notion of fairness, but what me and my advisor Siddharth came up is that there is, okay, if you restrict and see some particular probability distributions, which is the value densities, you can get some really interesting and cool results. And in particular, we show that whenever in a cake division instance you have that all the value densities, these VAs are either Gaussians or either binomial, or all of them are either Poisson, linear exponential, any single parameter family. What we have shown is we are developing polytime algorithm, efficient algorithm for finding empty cake division. So for a very, very wide class of instances, we are giving efficient algorithm. So that hardness lies somewhere out of these, somewhere beyond these classes. And the above results also holds true even when these value densities are linear translations of log concave distributions. And I would just want to throw in this word very quickly, which so the unifying property of all these distribution is what is called as monotone likelihood ratio property in statistics, or MLRP for short. So whenever you have cake division instances in which these value densities satisfy this property of MLRP, we are developing efficient algorithms for finding the NDC cake division. And okay, this is not relevant, but we also develop alternate proofs of existence while developing this algorithm. Like, we first show existence and it's an alternate proof of existence, and then we go on to develop algorithm. But in this area, there are very interesting structural properties that emerge, and the very interesting fact is that the existential guarantee in this class, existential guarantee for NDC cake division, it reduces to just one dimensional fixed point argument, and that is the most important feature that comes up here. And since we know that fixed point in one dimensional function can be computed efficiently via like a binary search, we get efficient algorithms. That reduction to 1D fixed point is what did the trick here. Just wanted to highlight these results, which are the recent ones. Okay, so I'll conclude my talk here. And okay, in summary, in the light of the algorithm barriers to find connected NDC cake divisions, we are developing efficient algorithms for first of all half NDC cake division, and also some results for other welfare notions, in particular for mesh social welfare. So one of the relevant threats to the future work would be to resolve the complexity of NDC cake division under cardinal variations, and also if possible to come up with a FPTAS for this problem, let's say at least under piecewise constant variations. Thank you.
Thank you, Nidhi. Anyone has any questions? So
just a quick question. I think I didn't follow the terminology efficient. Could you explain what efficient is?
Efficient
algorithm.
Yeah, efficient just means polynomial time involved. That's all it means.
Polynomial. I see. Okay, thanks.
I think you might be more familiar with the economic efficiency term, but it is also used for having polynomial time.
No, I was thinking in terms of minimum number of cuts or something like that. That was the connotation that I had.
Oh no, but here since we are having connected pieces, the number of cuts is fixed. It is n minus one.
No, but n minus one is. I see. Yeah. And you can
in case of disconnected pieces, you can talk about minimum number of cuts and so, minus one is the minimum you can achieve.
Okay, thanks.
I have one comment. Go ahead.
So Nidhi, I just wanted to ask a quick question, like, is there some easy way to figure out why having a contiguous thing is harder than having a non-contiguous cut?
So what happens in the disconnected setting or the non-contiguous setting, it is possible. What I do is I'll just chop the whole resource into very small pieces of value not more than epsilon to any agent, and then I can now group. So what then I'll start doing this, okay, the whole resource has been chopped up into very, very fine or very small pieces, each of value not more than epsilon, and then I'll just do a round robin procedure where the first piece goes to agent one, second to agent two, and so on till I complete one round, and I'll again start for the second agent. This is the most So for disconnected setting,
so can I conclude that in that case you can actually get this NV free cake division?
Yeah, you definitely can. Okay. But still over there also, you can get in finite time. But as I've talked about, even in that setting, we still don't know if we can get in polynomial time. But yeah, hyper exponential time at n to the power 6 stars of n is what is best known yet in the general setting.
Thanks a lot, Nidhi. Thank you.
So I have one comment. So is some property of the value